Hello and welcome to The Big Fight. I'm Nidhi Razdan. Well, with a big mandate come big expectations, and that is why Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman's first budget was being watched so closely. In the end, many believe she has played safe, outlining the government's intentions and goals certainly, but not announcing any big bang reforms or any big expenditure. The economy, as we all know, is facing huge headwinds right now, but has this budget done enough to change that? Is this a budget that is big on ideas but simply not bold enough? That's the big question we're asking on The Big Fight today. Let's first take a look once again at the key highlights of this budget in Modi 2.0. For you and me, firstly, what's going to matter is that petrol and diesel are more expensive by 2 rupees. In fact, there's excise duty that's up by 1 rupee and a road cess that's up by another rupee. So that adds up to those 2 rupees. Gold, precious metals are also going to be more expensive. Customs duty has gone up from 10% to 12.5%. The super rich, meanwhile, are going to pay much more tax. If you have an income of 5 crores and above every year, you'll be paying 7% more tax. If it's above 2 crores, between 2 and 5 crores, you'll be paying 3% more tax. Mercifully, the other tax brackets have not been affected. So the super rich being taxed much more. Then there is the 25% corporate tax, which already exists. It is now going to apply to firms that have a turnover of up to 400 crores. Earlier, it was for firms that had a turnover of up to 250 crores. And that, the finance minister said, applies to more than 99% of firms out there. That means the 0.7% that remain will still come under the 30% tax bracket. And by the way, big corporates are not happy about that because they had wanted to see a change there as well. And then startups, they have something to be happy about. They were complaining about angel tax for the last year. And the government has met them halfway, saying that there will be no scrutiny of valuations of share premiums. So they've eased some of those restrictions that came in with the angel tax. Let's just take a look at the key highlights, particularly on taxation, which the finance minister highlighted.
As I have started earlier, we have taken several measures in the past to alleviate the tax burden on small and medium income earners, as those having annual income up to 5 lakhs are not required to pay any income tax. We are thankful to the taxpayers who play a major role in nation building by paying their taxes. So far as corporate tax is concerned, we continue with phased reduction in rates. Currently, a lower rate of 25% is only applicable to companies having annual turnover up to 250 crores. I propose to widen this to include all companies having an annual turnover of up to 400 crores. To discourage the practice of making business payments in cash, I propose to levy TDS of 2% on cash withdrawal exceeding 1 crore in a year from a bank account. At present, startups are not required to justify fair market value of their shares issued to certain investors, including Category 1 alternative investment funds. I propose to extend this benefit to Category 2 alternative investment funds also. It is also proposed to increase custom duty on gold and other precious metals from 10% to 12.5%. It is also proposed to increase custom duty on gold and other precious metals from 10 to 12.5%.
Joining us on The Big Fight, we have Jay Panda, Vice President of the BJP. Also with us, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, General Secretary of the Congress Party. Mr. Pawan Verma of the JDU joining us shortly. Suman Sinha, the Chairman of Renew Wind Power, is joining us as well. And M.K. Venu, the Founding Editor of The Wire, here in the studio with us. Jay Panda, just to take this to you first. You know, I know you'll say that this is a great budget, but, you know, just in terms of the expectations that perhaps this was an opportunity for the Modi government with this massive mandate to take bolder steps. Most economists and experts today feel that that's not the case. It's not a big bang, big reformist budget. In fact, the government has chosen to play safe. How do you see it?
I don't think the government has chosen to play safe. If you look at some of the big ideas that are getting backing in this budget. So for example, the commitment to spend 1 lakh crores on infrastructure in the next 5 years is a very, very significant commitment. And at the same time, the government also has to be cautious because the economy, not just in India, but globally, the global economy has been slowing. And yet there is a commitment to maintain the fiscal discipline, the fiscal deficit to 3.3%. So in some areas, the government has to be very conservative. And in some other areas, it has made huge commitments. And these are not just commitments in the air, as some people might say. So let me tell you, the finance minister has documented some of the huge gains that have already happened. For instance, the 18,000 crores of rupees being saved every year now because of the large numbers of LED bulbs that have been distributed. And when this government talks about 1 lakh crores commitment to infrastructure, let's keep in
mind 100 lakh
that
crores.
Today, out of the 1 lakh 30... I'm sorry, yes, 100 lakh crores, my mistake. Please let us remember that fully 20% of all the highways in India today were built in the last 4 years. Out of the 1 lakh 32,000 kilometers of highways in India, one out of every 5 kilometers was built only in the last 4 years. So this government is not talking out of its head. It is talking on the basis of solid achievement already demonstrated.
But Jay, can
and
I
then
ask
shifting
you
gears.
That when there is a commitment to 100 lakh crore figure to spend on infrastructure, which is a massive number, there is nothing in the budget that actually lays out this how this expense is, I mean, you know, what the breakup of this expenditure is. It's not even there. So it's on paper that this is what we want to do, but we're going to set up a committee to look at how to do it. So it's just a promise. There is no blueprint on this expense.
No, I disagree. First of all, when the government has demonstrated in the last 4 years the massive speeding up of infrastructure construction, I think it has the credibility when it says it is going to step up the speed over the next 5 years. Number one. Number two, the difficult decisions which were taken in the first term, such as GST, is already beginning to kick in. The finance minister has given specific data of how much more revenues are coming in, both on direct and indirect taxation.
But there are shortfalls on GST revenue collection, which the economic survey has also highlighted as a key concern.
If you look at the last 4 months, yes, but if you look at the last 4 months, 3 out of the last 4 months, the GST revenues have been more than 1 lakh crores every month. That is hugely significant.
All right,
yes, the economy has slowed to 6.8%, but a lot is made of quarterly numbers sometimes.
All right, so Jyotiraditya Sindhya, when Jay Panda says that on a figure like 100 lakh crores for infrastructure spending, even if it's not there in the budget, the credibility of the government proves that if it says it's going to do this, it will do this. Is that good enough when you're presenting a budget which is essentially also supposed to give people figures? It's supposed to tell people, you know, this is how much money we're spending here and how we're going to do it. Or, you know, is there any other way to look at it, Mr. Sindhya?
Well, first of all, Nidhi, let me congratulate Ms. Sita Raman for presenting her first budget as the Finance Minister of India. My best wishes to her. She's starting a new innings in one of the most important posts that govern the country, and I wish her all the best. Having said that, I think a couple of things. A budget is not a blueprint for the country for the next 10 years or 15 years. A budget is an event. It is an event that describes how the economy is going to traverse itself over the next 365 days. And I found today's budget statement, wherein you've got a majority of 304 MPs in parliament, very shallow in terms of being strong, in terms of describing where is it and putting steps in place that where is it that this country is going to go in the next 1 year. It is very strong on intent, to what Jay was pointing out, but it is very weak on content. And I think that summarizes the budget statement today. For the first time, and I have seen now 17 budgets being presented in Parliament. This is the first time, unfortunately, that I'm looking at a budget on television as opposed to being in Parliament. But be that as it may, this is the first budget that I have heard over the last 17 years across successive governments of NDA and UPA, where not a single figure has been recounted. Nothing on total revenue, nothing on total expenditure, nothing on fiscal deficit, nothing on revenue deficit, nothing on estimations of what next year's numbers are going to look like. And mind you, even though she said that it's all in the details, when you're making a budget statement, 125 crore people across the country want to know the state of finances of the country. And that at least must form a part of the budgetary statement. Now, if you look across sectors, as Jay said, that there's a lot of intent of 100,000 crores on expenditure, on infrastructure. Every successful government has done that, whether it was Bharat Nirman in the UPA time or otherwise. If you look at the farming sector, there's nothing for the farming sector in this budget. There is nothing for employment, which is the crying need of the hour today. The India's economic engine is powered by savings and investment, both of which are at an abysmal low of 27% and 26.5%. And there is no steps in the budget to actually raise this level of savings and investment. Indian corporates today are investing abroad as opposed to investing in the country. So these are all concerns that we have to flag. Health and education, which is an area where Jay, along with me, is very, very passionate and concerned about. Both have received no importance in this budget. We talk about Ayushman Bharat, but then there is for 55 crore Indians, but then there is a paltry 1350 crores that is allocated to that.
Okay, but Mr. Sindhya, I
education
just
has received no increase
those points
in,
one
in
by
funding.
One back to Jay
so
Panda
these are
minute.
All concerns from a granular perspective for every single Indian across the country.
But Jay, just on that first point, that Jyotiraditya Sindhya raised was, on the fact that from the finance minister's speech, those figures were missing. And she said later at the press conference as well that, look, these are in the annexures. But in a budget, there has been a tradition to be upfront about the figures, like the fiscal deficit and so on. Why was that missing this time? Was it that there wasn't much to talk about?
Nothing is missing. I think we are all aware that over a period, over the last couple of decades, budgets have become much more than just an annual accounting listing of the annual accounts. Budgets have indeed become the big annual occasion to talk about the direction that the government is taking. And this is not a new thing. Even in governments in which Jyotiraditya Sindhya, my friend, was a minister, similar events have gradually been happening. So it's actually quite in line with the Indian trend to set the direction. Now, to say that figures are missing, now look at this. Direct tax revenue has increased in the last 5 years from 6 lakh odd crores to 11 lakh odd crores is given in the budget. Similarly, if you look at the amounts allocated for various line items, one of the big problems is the NPAs in the PSU banks, which is an overhang problem from the past 15 years. 70,000 crores has been allocated to further recapitalize banks after what was already done. Now, about the National Health Insurance Scheme, this money is not the only money that has been allocated. Money has been allocated earlier too. So it's
but
it's
Jay,
not
I think the point is when you
that,
look at different sectors,
are missing.
When you look at different like agriculture, rural development, etc., she didn't talk about those figures in her speech. And actually, when we went back and we looked at what was, for instance, allotted for agriculture in the interim budget a few months ago, and today's budget, it's exactly the same. It's 1.4 lakh crores. Rural development, 1.2 lakh crores back then, 1.2 lakh crores now. The Awas Housing Yojana, it's the same, 25,853 crores in February, 25,853 crores on the 5th of July. Is that one of the reasons why, she didn't actually spell these things out in her speech? because there's really been no change.
No, I think.
Or it's been marginal.
I think the policy implications in what has been mentioned in the budget are so significant that they are being, that the wood is being missed for the trees. You know, the direct commitment to come in with changes to the APMC restrictions on the farming sector, the ease of doing business commitment to do to the farm sector, which is already happening to the industrial and corporate sector, with India seeing the best improvement overall in the world over the last 5 years. Nearly 20 million houses to be built with toilets and electricity connections.
But those are all commitments, Jay. There's no money being allotted for this. That's my point. The point is there's no change from the February.
So when you said...
There's no change from the interim budget.
You know, it does not have to have a change. Look, every line item does not need a change from the interim budget. Every line item does not need
but
a change.
But doesn't the PM's Kisan Yojana, for example, Jay, let me just give you this example. The PM's Kisan Yojana is at 75,000 crores now, right? And actually, the Prime Minister himself has said it will be about 87,000 because it's been expanded to cover more farmers. That's not reflected in the budget numbers today. Sorry, Mr. Sindhya wants to come in on that point. And then I'll come to the rest of the panel. Mr. Sindhya.
There is of course going to be a revised estimate later in the year.
It needs to be,
My sympathies are with Jay because he's trying to be economical with the truth and trying to defend the indefensible. Okay, this is like a company going in for a annual conference of its performance and not telling you what its total sales have been, what its total expenditure has been, what its EBITDA numbers are, what its net profit numbers are, what its depreciation is, and saying that I am giving you the direction this year in the annual accounts for where I am going to take the company 10 years down the road from a strategic point of view. Is that good enough for its shareholders? Today, the shareholders of India are 125 crore people in this country. Should they not have got the numbers on total revenue, total expenditure, fiscal deficit, revenue deficit? Yes or no? That's the simple answer. My question is, show me one budget in the last 70 years in this country where numbers on total revenue, total expenditure, fiscal deficit and revenue deficit have not been announced in the budget statement. If you do that, I rest my case.
Okay, let me just get to the other panelists. Suman Sinha, let me ask you.
As far as your question on allocations is concerned, you're dead on. There is no numbers being spelt out in the budget on allocations because there is no increase. Manrega, for example, has been slashed. Where the Prime Minister talks about water being a key issue for our country, which it absolutely is. 40% of India is going to go through an arid condition throughout the year. There, they have combined two ministries, the Irrigation Ministry and the Sanitation and Drinking Water Ministry. And if you look at the combined budgets of both the ministries, there is a cut of 2,955 crores in the budget. So the devil lies in the details. And the details have not been spelt out by the finance minister because the details will belie the statements that they are mouthing. Okay. And therefore, this government will not be able to walk the talk.
Okay, let me just get the other panelists in. Suman Sinha, let me ask you that one of the big things that the economic survey had said earlier in the week was that we have to revive investment. It's all about investment. That's the way, you know, we are going to be able to get growth to go up. And they set out that target of 7%. A, do you think that this is a budget that does that? That actually, you know, provides a climate for that private investment to pick up? And B, this tax on the super rich. You know, Anand Mahindra has tweeted about that, saying that this increased income tax has spooked the markets. How do you see it?
Well, you know, just to put in a comment on the debate that was going on earlier about whether the budget speech was appropriate or not to the occasion, I think there's nothing wrong if the government comes in for a fresh five-year term. It has already been ruling for the last 5 years. For it to take the opportunity when all the cameras are on it and all the eyes are on it to basically espouse what their achievement has been for the last 5 years and what they plan for the next 5 years. I think there's nothing wrong with that. I don't think that anybody is trying to hide any numbers here to the point that was being made earlier. All the numbers are there in the budget. Anybody who wants to see them can see them. It is just that they haven't been mentioned in the budget. I think the finance minister has chosen to have her own mark on the budget speech and has therefore chosen to go with a slightly different presentation of facts, with the numbers being there for everybody to see in any case in the budget documents. So I don't think that there's anything amiss for her to have treated the speech as she has. I don't think it makes it's such a big deal. Now, coming to the questions that you asked me, Nidhi, in terms of whether this budget does enough to revive investment demand or the overall growth in the economy or not, and whether we'll be able to achieve the 7% target that the economic survey has set, I think let's look at the factors that were constraining growth in the last year, as a result of which, the GDP growth went down from 8.2% in quarter one to 5.8% in quarter four. I think there were a couple of factors. Number one, of course, we had the elections in quarter four. I think a lot of discretionary purchases, a lot of investment decisions, therefore, were getting postponed. And so, therefore, to me, the 5.8 is not really reflective of where the economy is at right now on a steady state basis. We are probably a little bit higher than that. How much, of course, it's hard to say, but I do feel that we are higher than that number. And so, therefore, the stretch to get to the 7% is not perhaps from 5.8 to 7, but from a higher number to 7. And so, the gap is not that large to begin with. The second thing is, the other factor that was constraining growth to some extent was the fact that the financial market liquidity had tightened up very considerably. Public sector banks have not been lending for some time on account of their NPA problems and so on. And the second thing was that NBFCs also had gone into some liquidity issues, and therefore they were also not lending to the consumption side, to the consumer side. And therefore consumption demand had also begun to flag.
So what is the big new idea in this budget?
So I think, I'm just coming to that, Nidhi. So look, I think there is an attempt that has been made in the budget to sort out the financial aspect, to try to make sure that liquidity in the system comes back. Number one is obviously the recapitalization of the banking system by another 70,000 crores. The last amount that was given was 40,000. This is a significant increase on that.
But is it
enough? So the hope is that would allow public sector banks to come out of the PCA and start lending a little bit more. And the second thing is on the NBFC side as well. A number of new ideas have been mooted. For example, the partial credit guarantee for up to 1 trillion rupees of NBFC loans. So the hope would be that some of these things allow the NBFC situation to also resolve itself.
Okay.
And allow the liquidity to come back into the system without creating moral hazard.
Okay, so I think the political climate and the uncertainty about the elections also had a role. Mr. Sinha, just to get a view here on that from Pawan
yes.
Verma, who's an ally of the government and from the JDU. Mr. Verma, what pleased you about the budget and what didn't? I know you're very candid in your views, so what worked for you and what didn't?
Nidhi, let me be as candid as possible. On the whole, we welcome this budget because we see it as a statement of intent, not necessarily limited only to the empirical facts about 1 year, but about a 5 year period ahead. And we welcome in particular, we welcome the goal of making India a $5 trillion economy. Now, I'm not saying that it will necessarily be reached, but all goals are aspirational and they provide a target to which the economy gradually needs to be geared up and a goal that we need to aspire to achieve. So I think that was one of the key themes of the budget speech, that so henceforth the measures that will be taken on the economic side will be to reach a goal of that magnitude and quantum, and even though it appears to be ambitious, this is what we are going to try to achieve. In that context, some of these the facts of the budget relating to strategic disinvestment, the investment in infrastructure, the hope that labor laws will be codified or there will be significant changes, the interventions with regard to women, the emphasis on housing, these are all areas, the new areas for FDI investment are all part, I think, of that larger strategy. There are two other factors which are specific but which touch the quality of the lives of people, which I want to commend about the budget. One is the scheme of providing to the ordinary person portable piped water. Can you imagine in this country we are somehow caught up between statistics and growth rate figures, but in our country, because of the large number of the unacceptably poor, water has become one of the critical issues. And the scheme of Har Ghar Nal, actually, if I may be allowed to take a little credit for it as a representative of Bihar, this is a scheme under implementation in Bihar as part of the 7-point program, Har Ghar Nal Ka Jal. And we are very happy that it is now being replicated on a national scale. The third aspect which we want to highlight in the budget is the new emphasis for electric vehicles. I think it shows a sensitivity towards the environment, which is good. Now, there are three negatives, if not negatives, areas of concern, which I'll mention in 30 seconds. The finance minister mentioned that in the railway sector, there will be private-public partnership. While in principle, we welcome that, we hope that this does not open the floodgates towards the privatization of the railways, which we believe would be a wrong step. Secondly, the budget does not have any statement of intent with regard to a very large swathe of India which is institutionally mired in the vicious cycle of poverty, and I am referring to the least developed states. Many of them have sought affirmative action, including special category status, and I include in this not only Bihar but Orissa, West Bengal, of course Andhra Pradesh is there. I think something must be done in the sensitivity of future budgets by which you understand that the successful states cannot secede to form their own republic, and you have to carry India as a whole, and these are very highly population dense areas which need an intervention, a strategic intervention, affirmative action in their favor.
Okay, Mr. Verma.
And lastly, I think, finish. Lastly, I think the increase in the price of petrol and diesel is a matter of some concern, because it may have a cascading effect on prices across the country, and certainly the middle class will not like it, if not even the lower middle class and poorer people.
Okay, so Venu, as you listen patiently sitting here, I mean, what does this budget have to actually enthuse corporate India to invest in India? Because they're investing right now, but outside of India. Suman Sinha seems to be optimistic. But what is there that actually makes him optimistic? I mean, just in terms of, is it just the recapitalization of banks at 70,000 crores? Is that enough?
Well, 70,000 crores is not enough, because Urjit Patel recently made a presentation at Stanford where he has argued that banks are still very undercapitalized. But you know, my problem with this budget is, I concede that it has a lot of intent. You know, Mr. Modi has started a whole range of welfare scheme, but what I find missing in the budget is, where is this growing welfare state being, how is it being funded? And when you look at the fiscal math, there are huge gaps that I see. You know, for instance, again, lack of transparency. In the afternoon, the finance secretary says that the huge increase in revenue receipts, which is of 25% increase, I've just calculated the numbers. There was a big shortfall last year. The actual collection last year about 15.5 lakh crores, and this year budgeted is 19.6 lakh crores. Big increase. So he says, and in a scenario of GDP stagnating, taxes are not going to provide this kind of revenue growth. So he said that we have factored in 90,000 crore, which we are going to sort of get from RBI surpluses. Now, the RBI surplus is being looked at by a Jalan committee, which is still unresolved. He is yet to formally present his recommendation.
So, that's out of the question. Why
didn't the finance minister talk about Jalan, the fact that they have actually, they have factored in 90,000 crores, which they want to, appropriate from the RBI surpluses, which is very controversial. And number two, Nidhi, I don't believe the fiscal numbers of this government, because the RBI has also, Viral Acharya, before he quit, he stated that the fiscal numbers, even the last year, the center is not adding a lot of borrowings that they're doing through other public sector organizations like Food Corporation, the oil companies, which are doing essentially government subsidy program, last mile electricity. If you add all that to the fiscal number, then you get a totally different picture. So all I'm demanding is just be transparent,
Okay, let me take that to Jay. Venu says you need more transparency. Mr. Chidambaram says this is the most opaque budget that he has seen. What would you say?
First of all, I think the allegation that this budget doesn't have numbers has already been countered. But I just want to use the same analogy that Jyotiraditya Scindia used of a corporate annual report and say that, I think a lot of people are nowadays getting literate about balance sheets, and they should not expect that detailed numbers should be there in the director's report. It should be there in the accounts, and it is there in this budget in the annexures for anybody who cares to read it. I had already mentioned the growth in direct revenues, the revenue collections of 15.6 lakh crores very specifically mentioned. So to answer Venu's last point about numbers not adding up, now let's take for example the commitment to a 3.3% fiscal deficit. Now there should be no reason to doubt this, because this government has demonstrated over the past 5 years that it can maintain the fiscal discipline to keep the fiscal deficit down. Now, we can talk about some prices going up, for example, in petroleum. But the fact is, if you don't keep the fiscal deficit down, you're going to again start igniting inflation. And I don't think enough credit has been given to the fact that inflation has been managed. And as recently was discussed, that the last elections was the first one in living memory where inflation was not a factor. It was not part of anybody's campaigning. Now, this is a result of economic management.
Sure.
So I'll summarize by saying this.
My point is fiscal deficit is way higher than what they predicted.
Let me just summarize this.
I think Venu is actually just questioning the numbers. He's questioning the data. And unfortunately, our data has come into question with all the controversies over the GDP, etc.
I'm not questioning it. Viral Acharya.
No, you're not being fair.
Viral Acharya has
let
put
me
it,
answer that.
He's put it on record. He's put on record that this actual center's fiscal deficit.
I understand what you're saying.
If you take the
public sector
borrowing,
okay, let Jay answer that. Yeah.
Let me answer that. Some doubts were raised about the way GDP was calculated, and that has been very, very vociferously answered by many eminent economists, saying that the alternate suggestions that were being given for GDP calculation formulas, if they were applied to other countries, most other countries in Europe and in America would show vastly less GDP, which is totally unrealistic. So, we can keep arguing about the validity of the data. I think that's unjustified. Now, about Venu's point about fiscal deficit, you can argue that the numbers are wrong, but whichever way you look at it, you take apples to apples, fiscal deficit has gone down. You can't compare apples to oranges and then say that fiscal deficit has not gone down. The fact is, the government has made very specific allocations for a wide range of items. We have talked about a 70,000 crores here or an 18,000 crores per annum savings. But take a look at some of the smaller ones. 400 crores allocated to creating institutes of world-class standards. And I think it was very relevant when the finance minister pointed out that 5 years ago, we had not a single institute of higher learning in the global 200.
Okay,
today we have three of them.
Okay,
so why should we not treat the government's commitment as credible?
Okay, well, Mr. Scindia, you're shaking your head vigorously or somewhat vigorously. Tell us why.
See, Nidhi, what I don't understand is why don't we take the facts that are on the table and analyze the government's performance based on that? Okay. Now, Suman is very sanguine that we have reached the trough and now we are going to ascend on the crest. I am not that confident as a economist, however limited I may be. You have today a 5.8% GDP growth rate over the last quarter. Your GST collection has gone down to 4.5% in the last quarter. your GDP growth rate having fallen, your savings rate and your investment rate over the last 5 years have not climbed from 27-28%. You're making a profound statement that in the last 5 years we have grown from a 1.8 trillion economy to a 2.7 trillion economy, which is a 45% growth. And in the next 5 years, we're going to grow from 2.7 trillion economy to a 5 trillion economy, which is a 100% growth. You are, if you look at the issue of farm growth, where 16% of your GDP comes, but 65% of your employment comes, you are at an abysmal low of 2.9%. If you look at manufacturing as a share of GDP growth has grown only 0.5% over the last 5 years. If you look at unemployment, we are at a historic 45-year high of 6.1%. The same NSSO figures that Venu pointed out, which were unacceptable by this government for the last 1 year, have been finally accepted by this government. 4.7 crore people have left unorganized labor force. Of which 3.7 crore are unorganized labor, of which 2.9 crore are farm labor. So your savings engine is not firing, your investment engine is not firing, your GDP, your GST collection is falling, your across the board growth rate is not growing, whether it's agriculture or farm or services. Where is the engine, GDP engine, going to fire up from if your domestic investor is also not gung-ho, whether it is from the consumption side, the farmers, or from the investment side, the corporates? Okay. And where is your employment scenario going to work
actually,
out from? Your Make in India, your Startup India,
you know,
have been abysmal
failures.
You actually
have an important point.
So I want to be positive about India, but in a global environment where there's a trade war going on, where globally economies are going to start lagging, how are we going to boost Indian consumption and Indian growth? That is the challenge that we are facing today. And you had an opportunity to present a monumental change. But what you presented was only incremental at best, which is why I sum up the budget by saying it may be good in intent, but it is abysmally low on content.
Well, we have Yamini Iyer, a senior fellow at the Center for Policy Research, joining us. Suman Sinha has left the building like Elvis, but Yamini Iyer, you know, just on that point that Jyotiraditya Scindia was making about jobs in particular. Now, again, that's an issue we've been debating so much in the last year especially, but there is nothing again that jumps out in the budget on employment. What did you make of that?
No, absolutely. I think just to take what Mr. Scindia said forward, this was a monumental opportunity. You have a government that comes at the back of such a resounding mandate with an opportunity at the moment of a critical juncture. There is the economy is in a moment of significant slowdown and important challenges like jobs. These are the challenges that needed to be addressed. There is limited fiscal room. I wasn't expecting much in terms of increased allocations. I think that had been set in the interim budget. But this was the opportunity to really chart the course forward. For the moment, all that we are seeing in terms of what the government has on offer to address the crisis of jobs is more of the same. The skill development, attempts at doing skill development, tinkering a little bit with agriculture in the hope that some infusion of cash will help revive a little bit of demand. A little bit of focus on MSMEs, but not even catching the bull by its horns. And I think that's where it disappoints.
What would you have liked to have seen on job generation?
I would have liked to have seen a much, much more focused commitment to jobs generation, and specifically two things. A complete rehaul of the skilling effort. India is one of the few countries in the world that is trying to skill a population without doing basic education. If we have to do skilling, we need to move away from the traditional approach of thinking of skillings as schemes and thinking of skilling much more from the perspective of market, of what market is demanding. So at least a commitment to a white paper, forget allocations because I think there is limited room there, but at least a commitment to rethinking and restructuring the way in which the skill ministry is approaching skills is something that I would have liked to see.
Well, Jay, do you want to take on that question that, you know, was this an opportunity actually for the finance minister to have addressed the one issue I think everyone universally feels strongly about, which is employment or unemployment? And that was a missed opportunity in that sense.
it is an opportunity which has been seized. I'm sorry, I must disagree with my friend Yamini Iyer and some of the other panelists, because I don't have an answer for congenital pessimism. But let me come to the issue of jobs. Look, jobs is a structural issue in the global economy. We missed opportunities in earlier decades when we did not have a high enough growth rate. How do you create jobs? Look, the commitment to pare down more than 200 labor laws into a set of 4 codes, you think that is not going to create jobs? I have come from a private sector background, and I know people go out of their way to avoid creating jobs so that they don't have to deal with this Kafkaesque labor law system. This indeed is a specific commitment to ease the creation of jobs. And to not recognize that, I think, is not fair. And if you move away from jobs, we were talking about the banking scenario. Nobody seems to want to give credit to the fact that after more than a decade, coming on from the previous government, the bank's NPAs have for the first time reduced by 1 lakh crores in the last 1 year. And 4 lakh crores has been recovered due to the bankruptcy code. Now, these are solid achievements. And the commitment to go forward to make massive infrastructural investments means one thing. Those who are looking for junk food and chatpata announcements in budget will be disappointed. Those who are looking for nutritious food with a solid basis of putting India on the growth path to a $5 trillion economy will see plenty of evidence in this budget for that roadmap.
Well, well, then let me ask all the panelists that. Mr. Sindhya firstly wanted to come in on what you said on the labor codes as being a source of employment generation. Mr. Sindhya?
What people are looking for today in India is a climate that will augur for greater investment to happen. Why is the investment engine not taking off? Just please remember, Nidhi, that when the effect of investment in day zero, which is today, only reflects in GDP close to about day 500 down the road. It takes a close to about a 15-month cycle for that effect to have its veracity shown in terms of GDP numbers, in terms of new growth. So the slowdown also has a lag of a year and a half. The fact is today that we've got to turn our investment and savings engines up. You can only do that by ensuring corporate India and MSMEs that invest in India. We will provide that environment, whether it be through auguring much more investment in infrastructure or otherwise, like the UPA did with airports, with roads, with ports. All that you see today in the civil aviation sector today, the road sector today, is what the UPA did in those 10 years. That was when international majors were coming in the power sector, in the road sector, in the air sector. That's the sort of environment we need to create. Today, you ask any industrialist off camera, are they bullish about investing in India? The answer to you is going to be an absolute no.
Yeah, don't ask
them
on camera.
That is the environment that we need to create. You cannot do that by having a global investors meet, by doing a Davos in India. It's not going to change things. So that's what we need to create, an investor-friendly climate.
Yeah, one second.
That is the responsibility of administration.
Yamini, I had a comment on that.
Just to be fair, I think that one of the interesting turns in this budget, if you take the budget speech, is that it very early on talks about the need for kick-starting private investment and focuses head-on on infrastructure. It talks about connectivity, it talks about roads highways, ports, electricity, and so on. It even acknowledges, and that's where the disappointment comes, it even acknowledges that the critical issue with electricity is tariff regulation, and that we will look into it. But one hopes that for a government that has come back after being in power for 5 years, and therefore has understood some of the key issues, when it is presenting its most game-changing budget. This is a budget that is being presented. The context is important. It's being presented after the country has given it a resounding mandate, that it would have more to offer than just saying, we will look into it. And that's, I think, where it disappoints.
So you would have wanted to see more specifics, not
no,
just
we know, we know,
not generic we know, commitments.
We know there are very obvious sets of basic things that India needs to do to be able to improve its economy. There is a certain degree of consensus around that too. The challenge lies in how do you move beyond that consensus to address the wicked problems. And things like tariff regulation are the wicked problems. Things like maintenance of roads, these are the wicked problems. How do you get there? That's what we need to be looking at for a government that's come back after 5 years and is going to run its course for the next five.
So, Venu, if I had to ask you, if you just look at the sort of warnings that the economic survey gave, which actually was in a way paradoxical, because on one hand they said, well, things are going to get better, but there is a fear that growth can slow down. Mm. They've raised the concerns about GST revenue collections, oil prices, etc., because of the US sanctions on Iran oil. Therefore, can India achieve that $5 trillion target that it wants to by 2024-25?
Nidhi, my big concern is yesterday when economic survey was presented by Subramaniam, Krishnamurthy Subramaniam, for the first 7-8 minutes, he was just in a PowerPoint, he was telling us to emulate China. He said, we must do what China did, create a virtuous cycle of high savings, high investment, high productivity and high employment. And yes, I guess he said that in the context of this huge infrastructure investment these people are planning. But I saw one contradiction in the budget. Instead of there is domestic savings pessimism. Savings are at an all-time low. So therefore, Nirmala Sitharaman has announced that she would go with a sovereign bond issue globally abroad, maybe $5-10 billion, and bring that here. So this is the first time that dollarization of fiscal deficit is happening, which is very risky. Most countries which have developed the infrastructure have done it through domestic savings. I wanted a roadmap on how will this 100 lakh crore over 5 years would happen. Not just a one-line statement that a committee would be appointed. Some ideas from the finance minister on what would be the components, what will be the public investment, what will be the private sector participation, what would be the private equity investment.
So is that $5 trillion target realistic in short?
See, $5 trillion from here on, from 2.8, this year it will be 3. After that, if you get even a 7.5% growth and 4% inflation, it's a modest target. It's no great achievement to go to $5 trillion. This $5 trillion sounds very sort of impressive, but simply by getting a 7.5% growth and a 4% inflation, which is actually below our potential output, you can get to $5 trillion. Yeah.
All right. Quick last comments. Jyotiraditya Sindhya, to you first. What did Jay say? A congenital pessimist is what he's calling those criticizing the budget. Are you seeing it only from that perspective? There's nothing that you're taking away from this as a positive?
I think India has tremendous potential. But India has as much potential as her leadership takes her to. And I think herein lies the conundrum. I think we must perform towards our potential, and I think that now we need a monumental change in India and not incrementalism. I do think that there are some good new ideas in the budget, such as the thought of a blue economy in terms of ensuring water conservation, green economy in terms of electric vehicles. But again, these are fringe allocations from a budgetary perspective, which I would have been much happier with much more higher allocations. And therefore, I say that this budget may have been good on intent, but is very disappointing with regard to content.
Jay, your last word tonight. Incremental sort of a budget, and that is a criticism that some other economists have leveled against Mr. Modi as well. That he was thought of as someone who would be this great reformer. It didn't happen in round one, and it's not going to happen in round two either. That he is somebody who will
Nidhi,
look at
also
reform
nothing
incrementally.
With regard to the new direct tax code or with regard to GST changes in GST. keeping in mind what they've experienced. All of those are things that one would have expected.
Jay, is it just incrementalism?
I love it. Jyotiraditya Scindia says that from $2.8 trillion to go to $5 trillion is next to impossible. And Venu says, it's an easy target. It's too easy. The reality is, it's not an easy target, but it's doable. It takes tough decision making, which is already happening. I referred to the labor code simplification as job creation. Jyotiraditya Scindia said that's not enough, requires investment in infrastructure and aviation, etc. What have I been saying? 100 lakh crores commitment to infrastructure is not big enough for you? I mean, have we ever seen anything like this in the history of Indian budgets? And in fact, specifically, aviation has been opened up for investment and insurance. So, I mean, if you want to be determinedly pessimistic, you will not see these things in the budget.
All right. Yamini Iyer, you get the last word.
I think just seeing an MRO for investment is not enough for civil aviation, especially when all carriers are bleeding, including Air India.
All right.
And no clear commitment that we're going to solve the Air India problem either, by the way. No, but I think the pessimism.
And also on disinvestment, you're going to have LIC buying shares of public sector investment companies. So it's moving from one hand to the other. Yeah. Right. Disinvestment means you're actually going to have pension funds and others coming in, not LIC buying the shares of public sector companies.
Yeah,
I mean, no, I just want to say, you know, just to reiterate the same point I'm making, I think that the sense of pessimism actually comes from a moment of optimism. And that moment of optimism comes against the backdrop of the election results. And therefore, a hope that this would be an opportunity to, in fact, really do the difficult, hard things that no political party of any color has been able to do in the past. I do think that it's important to recognize that they have been careful about not falling into the trap of any new schemes, new grand announcements. You look at the budgets of the last 3 years, every budget had one new thing which
last
tends to remain unfunded.
Yeah.
So these unfunded mandates have been curbed, and I think that's really important and sensible. The catch is, how do you fix the problems that you have today in order to be able to achieve what is, I think, a doable target of 5 trillion?
All right. Thank you very much to all of you for joining us on The Big Fight with that perspective on this big budget. And let's see what the next few months bring for the Indian economy. Thanks for joining us. Goodbye.